And so the reason why I want to talk about, I want to dive into this discussion now, is because events that are unfolding in the United States at this moment are significant enough that I think this the way I think about certain things and the information that is out there for people to latch onto and to be able to use is important enough that whether or not I have it perfect, whether or not I have it polished the way I think it could be and how impactful it might be, I think it needs to get out there now, and I think people need to chew on it. And for whatever I can offer in my little world, if I can share these ideas with the folks that typically follow me or that may end up seeing this video, and it gets you to go to these other resources and start learning for yourself and start breaking yourself out of this, I'm not trying to make it sound conspiratorial, but it, you know, for lack of a better way to say it, this mind control that we seem to be, this drug that we all seem to be under the influence of, we need to start breaking out, clearing our mind, and start thinking critically for ourselves. But we really need to start having a better understanding of each other and how to communicate, because issues within the United States and issues globally are not going to start getting easier. They're only going to get more difficult. And so if we can't handle this level of dialogue now in a constructive and responsible and efficient manner, we're doomed for later on when it really gets tough. So I'm hoping that if we have this conversation on the discussion of this understanding ideology, if we start to take a moment and understand how people think, if we understand how people think, how their brains are hardwired, how their mental processes engage within themselves, within issues, within topics, within discussions, within other people, within broader communities, if we can start to understand not only the other people that we're dealing with, that we have this sense of where things are not right and it's because of them, maybe. The other flip side might be things are not right and things don't feel right, maybe because of you and your lack of understanding of how you process things, how you engage things, how you have developed your value sets, how you are personally hardwired. And when you understand yourself and you understand the other person, now again, like I said, where I'm going to start drawing pretty pictures on the whiteboard here in a little bit, we start going down the road of we understand ourselves better, we understand other people better. Now we can understand how those two things may fit. Or maybe they don't fit at all. But at least now we understand it, and we can come to, as we decide to engage in dialogue or intellectual battle, if you will, we now have something we can focus on. We can find that common ground from which to come. And I'm jumping ahead as far as where we're going to go with this. But, all right. So, yeah, I jumped ahead. I'm just looking at my notes here, blah, blah, blah. Sportsman. So, again, if we're looking at those people that know me from a sportsman's world, and you're sitting there asking me, well, Chris, again, you shouldn't focus on this. No, I absolutely should focus on this. This is going to be critical. Understanding ideology is critical when we as sportsmen deal with one another. I've talked about all the time that in the sportsman community, we have the uber left and the uber right. They all buy hunting licenses. They all go fish and hunt. And a lot of them enjoy bird watching and wildlife watching and all the other things. But there are those that are on the political left, ideological left spectrum and ideological right spectrum. If we're going to sit in front of a wildlife commission, if we're going to go argue a case before or our desires before our wildlife agencies, we're going to have a better understanding of how to communicate with one another. Especially when we have those that don't value consumptive use, that don't value hunting or fishing or trapping, want to push forward a ballot initiative, like recently wolf reintroduction in Colorado, or whether they want to ban all trapping. Okay, New Mexico right now in 2021 is dealing with some of this stuff. It doesn't matter if we're talking about issues amongst ourselves within the sportsman community, or whether we're talking about issues that are quote-unquote seen as adversarial with those that are outside the community, the consumptive versus non-consumptive user groups battling over ideologies and policy. We better darn well start to better understand their position, where they're coming from, and actually understand our position and where we're coming from, if we're going to have a successful dialogue in the public arena to hopefully come up with a public policy that either is righteous for whatever side of that coin it is, or at the very least, has the most beneficial compromise for all parties to move forward in a constructive and healthy manner into the future. We need to. All right? So let's dive into this. Understanding ideology. Let me throw massive qualification in this discussion right up front. And I'm saying this slowly for those in the back that aren't listening carefully, that as this unfolds, want to try to pick this thing apart. I applaud you to, absolutely, I encourage you to pick this apart. And I would encourage you, if there is something fundamentally wrong with what I'm saying, provide a constructive correction in the, what do I say? In the spirit of moving this discussion forward in a constructive and positive manner. I don't give two rips if I tripped up on some little thing and you're like, nah, well, you don't know what you're talking about, because, yeah, you're right, I don't. I'm still learning. But this is what I understand as of yet. So, with that being said, these are my opinions. These are my opinions. These are my opinions based on listening to Dr. Peterson, the Weinstein brothers, Rubin. I can't even, those are the ones that who else? Jeez, oh, there's so many people that I've just, Thomas Sowell, holy, jeez, how did I forget that one? Thomas Sowell was a fundamental influence on me and my understanding in a lot of this and my eventual development down this road. These are my opinions. I know for a fact that they're probably not going to be perfect. And I understand that. I've already articulated in the beginning where I know that they're not perfect. I want them to be perfect, but they're never going to be perfect. And so at some point, you just got to talk. You just got to move forward and talk. Sorry, well, I forgot to put my phone on. Airplane mode. Boom. Because you know darn well somebody's going to call in. Or it's going to get feedback on the microphones. I know these are my opinions. I know they may not be perfect, but I know they're pretty darn close. And quite honestly, I'm sharing this because this is how I visualize the world. This is how I personally make sense of this topic. And I use the visual to manipulate and I use the visual to influence how I engage my ideas on the landscape and with other people. Hopefully that makes sense. Again, influencers in my life, absolutely Thomas Sowell. You're going to hear me talk about A Conflict of Visions, his book, A Conflict of Visions. In my opinion, if this discussion resonates with you, that is must read. You must read that book. Warning, it is not a coffee table book. It doesn't have a lot of pretty pictures. In fact, I think it has zero pictures. But it's going to have some meat and potatoes and gristle and bone that you're going to have to chew through. There's so much information in there that will absolutely blow your mind on understanding how people are hardwired when we, and especially when it gets down to when we're talking about ideology. Likewise, Dr. Jordan B. Peterson, I cannot even, if you don't know who he is, you're wrong. If you believe that he's some evil bad guy that's just, you're wrong. You owe it to yourself to go investigate who he is truthfully. Because the reason why so many, there are some on the, and I'm going to say that the ideological progressive, postmodern progressive leftist side of the equation are so hell-bent on destroying him is because he utterly destroys their position. He wakes people up to the lunacy of their position, the hypocrisy of their position, how it is absolutely an untenable position on the broad spectrum of society and policy. Doesn't mean that some of the things that they value are not valid. No, it means how they want to articulate, how they want to place their ideology on the landscape oftentimes is untenable. He absolutely destroys them. And so, obviously, there are people on the left that want to bring him down and limit the sphere of influence that he has. But you cannot argue the fact that when he goes and does a public lecture around the globe in different countries, in different cities, he will pack arenas, theaters. Millions of people have gone to listen to his lectures. And these are intellectual lectures. He has... It's got to be hundreds of hours of high-level thinking lectures that are high-level thinking, but easily understood. He is a masterful educator on very deep concepts on how the human brain works and how the human animal on the landscape has executed themselves on the landscape over time. He is incredible at helping you make sense of so many of the little things that are going on in your head that you're like, I don't understand how this, but he helps bring everything together. And he has been an incredible intellectual influence on my education. And then more recently, Brett Weinstein, Eric Weinstein, Dave Rubin, and others who are generally or used to be considered on the left. I generally consider myself maybe on the right. And so many cases, those of us, and we're going to get to this here in a minute, those that are that identify ourselves on the right side of this, the ideological or political spectrum, oftentimes we don't, and this is wrong on our behalf. We don't go and seek out and engage those on generally the ideological left side of the spectrum in a constructive, honest, meaningful way. We'll hear sound bites from them and then we instantly just throw up our hands and we want to fight them. I don't know if this fits now, but there's a quote. I love quotes and this one came up and I don't remember who it's from, but... when faced with a decision to change one's mind or prove that there's no reason to do so, most everyone gets busy on the proof. That was, someone said that a long time ago, and it's absolutely brilliant because it's absolutely right. When faced with a decision to either change your mind on something or engage in intellectual battle, to prove that you don't need to change your mind, almost every one of us gets busy on the proof. And we don't meaningfully engage the other side. We don't take a minute to understand where they're coming from. We don't, you know darn well, I don't care what side of the spectrum you're on. If you are in an argument with another person, I don't care if it's, you are a left, you identify with the left side of the ideological spectrum, and you're engaging with someone on the right, or you're just dealing with your spouse or your significant other or your child. You know darn well there are times where you know what your intent was. You know where you were coming from, but you did not articulate it well. And it came across wrong. And it was misinterpreted. And now, crap, now the whole frickin' discussion is screwed up. Because I came from a good place. I came from my position where I thought I was righteous. I came from this position that I thought was good and I wanted to put it forward. And I screwed up. And I didn't do it well enough for the other person to receive it. You know damn well that that happens on your side. So why in the world could it not possibly happen on the other side? To where what we hear from our quote-unquote political enemies or ideological enemies maybe is not very far from what we believe. Maybe they just didn't bring it forth correctly. And what do? We get busy on the proof. You're wrong, and here's why. Versus maybe we should have taken 2 minutes and said, okay, whoa. Is this what you mean? Is this how... And taking a moment to get to the core of what they're actually saying, to understand them, and then figure out whether or not we truly are that far off. I have been pleasantly surprised and influenced by some very honest, refreshingly honest intellectuals that hold much more liberal views, left-leaning views than I do. I am grateful that I listened to those lectures, those podcasts, listened to what they were saying, because it absolutely expanded my mind, blew me away on how close we were on so many things, and how clear they know we are close, and why they are now frustrated with the direction that society is going, because we're not moving together. We are purposefully moving apart, and that is going to be problematic. So, these are my opinions. They're not going to be perfect. This is how I personally wrap my head around things, and there are a number of people that have influenced this, my thought process. And I really implore you to go and investigate these individuals as well. Thomas Sowell, Jordan Peterson, Brett Weinstein, Eric Weinstein, Dave Rubin, some of his stuff, and the list can go on. But you're going to hear me bring those names up throughout this. All right. All right, so let me start putting pretty pictures on the whiteboard. All right, when we hear people talk about ideology, I want you to think about a horizontal line. Okay? Just draw a horizontal line. A lot of people will say on the left end of this line are the left. Let me just take it step by step. We got the left side of the line, and we got the right side of the line. There are those... If we just kind of mark the middle of that line as the dividing line, there are those that want to say everybody on the right is the right. The evil, quote unquote, evil right. And that anybody that's on the left is that liberal, leftist, progressive, socialist, communist, whatever. There are people that just want to lump. They just want to draw a line down the middle of that. They want to divide the horizontal line in two. Everybody on the left-hand side is this socialist communist. Everybody on the right-hand side of the line is this, you know, fascist alt-right POS that everybody, you know, should hate. The problem is we know that that's not, it can't be true. Because we know from just the right, if we look at those that believe on the right side of the spectrum, we know that there are some conservatives. Well, there we go. Let's just use the word conservative, okay? Conservative doesn't necessarily mean quote-unquote right. Because you can be a liberal conservative. How is that, Chris? It's an oxymoron. No. No, it's not. You can have a general liberal that is not a leftist. And quite honestly, you can have a leftist that's maybe not quite all the way over to the far, you know, the socialist, communist type of person. They're farther left-leaning than maybe your classic liberal. Likewise, you can have fascists on the right side. You absolutely can have fascists on the uber right side, the alt-right or whatever. But you know darn well from our even our own ideological community that I don't identify with fascism. I don't identify with the alt-right. I don't identify with white nationalism and blah, 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 blah. But I generally consider myself a conservative. So the people that want to divide this, to have this line, just as a horizontal line, they're fundamentally, ideologically wrong. In my opinion, they're fundamentally, ideologically wrong. It is not a line. It's way more complex than that. There's way more intricacy in how people manifest themselves along an ideological spectrum than a horizontal line. If you're listening to anybody for your ideological feedback, your recreational enjoyment, your listening enjoyment, or from an educational standpoint that is talking about a left and right, a horizontal line and the left versus the right, left versus the right, left versus the right, they are manipulating you. They are purposefully manipulating you because a horizontal line like this is very easy to keep the dialogue within an emotional realm. If I can convince you that everyone on the left side of the line, the middle of the line, everything on the left side of the line is wrong, and here's why they're all wrong, I can very easily use emotional triggers to keep you believing that and actually be like, yes, they're all bad. Likewise, those on the left that want to just say everybody on the right side of that line is wrong and here's why, and they point to the fascists and the alt-right and the neo-Nazis and blah, 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 blah. And then you, as an emotional person, you go, oh, yeah, see, they're over there, so everybody on the right side of the line is wrong. Okay, they're using this to manipulate how you think so that way you will think how they want you to think so they can achieve the, whether it's political, social, value set, whatever, they can achieve their desired outcome in the discussion. If you can control the dialogue, you can control the discussion. If you control the discussion, you control the outcome of whatever you're endeavoring to do, all right? And this is why, and social media is going to come up later on in this discussion here very, very solidly. So the conventional way of thinking about left versus right has almost always been, this horizontal spectrum, this horizontal line. It's wrong. Here's my idea. Here's what I believe. I'm going to draw a circle, and it's one take. We're going to draw a circle, and we're going to see how good I am. Not bad. I'll accept that one. That's actually pretty good. Okay, so draw a circle. All right. With this circle, hold on. Let me get that next. I want you to look at it not so much as a circle. I want you to look at this as a color wheel. So it is a circle, but all of the material within the circle is relevant. We're not just talking about the perimeter edge of a circle. We're talking about everything within the confines of that circle. Whether we're talking about a plate, a color wheel. Imagine a color wheel, you know, when you're doing Photoshop stuff or you got to pick a color and you click on it and you comes up with this wheel, and there's all sorts of colors and all sorts of different gradations and saturations of colors, blah, 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 blah. That's how I want you to visualize this, okay? All right. So we have a circle. Like we were just talking about in the beginning, or just a moment ago, it is very easy for people to want to segregate people into left versus right. And that's not necessarily wrong. The verbiage, the nomenclature used to identify that might technically or somewhat be wrong, but then I guess the manifestation and the generality of it is actually pretty darn close, okay? So we can look at this circle, and if we were, let's just say we draw a, okay, I'm not going to draw this yet for people who are listening. So if we were just to imagine we cut this circle in half, top to bottom, we have on the right side, we have the right side of the ideological spectrum. On the left side of the circle, we have the left side of the ideological spectrum. There are those that would just go ahead and draw a solid line, top to bottom, 12 o'clock to 6 o'clock. They would just draw a solid line right through the middle of that circle and say, left versus right. Done. I'm not going to do that because I don't think that's how the ideological arena works. Here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to visualize where I'm going to say that's the center of the circle. It's probably wrong. I don't care. I'm going to say that's the center of the circle. Put a little dot there. Starting at that dot, I'm just going to start moving towards the 6 o'clock position of that circle. I'm going to do another dot, another dot, another dot. Maybe I'm going to do a little bit of a line, another little bit of a line, dash line, almost like Morse code, dot, dot, dash, dash. Okay. So I'm going to start doing a little dash, maybe another dash. Maybe this little dash is a little bit longer. Maybe this little dash is a little bit longer. Maybe the next dash is a little bit longer. And then all of a sudden, I'm going to get to a point where I'm just going to make a solid line all the way to the bottom of the circle. All right? Actually, let me just darken this up so you can see it a little bit. So what we have is a circle. And at the very bottom, we have a solid line moving upwards that slowly transitions into a dashed line, and those dashes get smaller and smaller and smaller until they become dot, 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 and then the last little dot ends at the center of the circle. In my mind, this is the appropriate dividing line between right and left of this circle. Yes, in the north, I get, why not? North is usually at the top of the, anybody that does mapping and stuff, north is usually at the top of the map. And if you're looking at satellite imagery, north is at the top of the imagery. So sorry, that was just a default position, north. If we do look at everything at the north half of the circle, at the top half of the circle, there's no dividing line between right and left. But you know darn well, you can look at that void, you can look at that area, and you can see, well, I understand that there's left and right up there, but there's no visible, physical dividing line. However, we start at the center of this. As we start to move south, and we start to move towards the 6 o'clock position, we start to drop down to the bottom of the circle, there starts to be this division. There starts to be this hard line of demarcation where it's clear when we get down to the bottom one quarter roughly, let's say bottom one quarter of the circle, it's a clear vertical line. It's a clear demarcation. Areas on the left are different than areas on the right. All right? Does that make sense? At least from that point right now. All right? That's how Hold on. It's my shirt. I'm telling you, I've wrestled with a year on trying to figure out a way to articulate this, so just give me a second so I can make sure I'm on track and I'm not missing anything and I'm not just going off in a random rabbit hole that doesn't need to be talked about, okay? So. All right. So we're on track. So we do have left and right general ideologies that actually is talked about, but well, I think Thomas Sowell talks about it in his book, but also Dr. Peterson talks about it. Dr. Peterson has a course. It's called, he's got understandmyself.com where you can go through and take a personality test and figure out how your personality manifests itself, who you are. It's brilliant. I think everyone should take it. However, I think you also should take his personality course, jordanbpeterson.com. He has a course on understanding personality. My recommendation, having gone through both, I would take his, I would go to understand, well, no. Go ahead and sign up for the personality course. Pay for that course. You'll start to go through the course. As you start to go through the course, he's going to give you a coupon code that allows you to take the personality test, understandmyself.com. It's going to give you a coupon code where you can do that for free. I don't know if this is correct. I don't know if this is right. I think it's right. For me, it would have been. As soon as you get that coupon code, you jump in and you take the personality test. And you think about all of those questions. It's going to ask you a series of questions. There are no right and wrong answers. It's asking about you. How do you think? Do you value this or this? Blah, blah, blah. More so, less so. And you're just answering for yourself. You answer it truthfully, brutally. Brutally truthfully. But you think about it. Make sure you think about the questions and you understand what the question is asking you. Because as a segue, I took it and there was a couple questions that my mindset at the time, I was thinking about this thing or this group of things. And so this group of things and what was going on in my life at this moment, I answered it a certain way. And because of that, out the other end comes these results. But then after it was done and several days later and I'm thinking about things, I realized, well, wait a minute, Chris. That question was asking about all these things. And I, because of what was going on in my life, I was just tackling this portion. And so I didn't answer that question probably as accurately for myself as I could have been. Yes, was I influenced, let's say, negatively? Because of these things. Yeah, I was. But if I looked at everything as a whole, no. I'm maybe better or more satisfied or more decided, whatever. I would have changed my answer a little bit. So I'm telling you to go through it. This is fundamental for your personal development and understanding yourself, understanding your ideology, and then being able to understand others. So I beg of you, please take the dang thing. Sign up for the Understanding Personalities course. You'll get a coupon code that allows you to take the understandingmyself.com, that the personality test. I would jump and take the test as honestly as you can. And then don't even look at the results. Then go back to the personality course and go through the whole thing and understand all the aspects, learn as much as you can and understand, physically understand as to the greatest extent possible all the aspects of the big five personality traits that he goes through. And then when you're done, you go back and take it again. Take the personality course again and see if it's changed a little bit. Or just at the very least, review your results and then it'll help you understand where you came from. But for me, when we look at this circle, I truly believe that when we're looking at left versus right, there are a lot of factors that go into how we in our brains process things, how we in our brains develop our value sets, how we in our brains end up developing our personalities. And I think those do, it's not only personality, but also life experiences, our direct life experiences and those around us influence how we end up on this spectrum, whether we generally fall on the left, whether we generally fall on the right. And I say generally for a very specific reason. And I'm going to talk about that here coming up. But in general, understand, this circle, in my mind, is not clearly divided left and right until you start getting closer to the bottom of the circle. That's where battle lines are drawn. That's where hard walls are drawn. All right? And so I think this is representatively correct from an ideological standpoint. And here's what's going on. The other thing. Okay? Thomas Sowell, in his book A Conflict of Visions, talks about the constrained versus the unconstrained mindset. And that mindset, my interpretation of that book was, in many ways, that is how a human brain is hardwired. Your human brain, my human brain, anyone else's, we all have a hardwiring. All of ours are going to be slightly different. And in his book, he describes the unconstrained mindset. These are just broad generalities. You need to go read the book. A Conflict of Visions. Thomas Sowell. If I was to generalize it, in that book, he talks about the unconstrained mindset, where if we were to just take the far side of that, ends justify the means. Meaning, the general philosophy, the ideology is ends justify the means. I'm here. I want to be over there on this opinion or this policy, this action, this argument, whatever. I'm here at point A, and I need to be at Z. If we take the whole alphabet, let's say, I want to go from A to Z. For a person that has a general unconstrained mindset, they don't give two rips about how they get there. They'll jump straight to Z if they can. If they need to crush D, bulldoze over F, G, and H, go under M, N, O, P, and L, M, N, O, P, and then pop out and just run over top of all the other ones and just jump on Z, okay, fine, don't care. We did it. I'm at Z. I got to where I wanted to be. My ideal, my opinion, my desire is utmost important, and I will do whatever it takes to get to that end point. I don't give two rips about what happens in between. Ends justify the means. Constrained mindset. Now, I tell you what, let's just go ahead and draw. Well, no. Let me explain it. And then I'm going to draw. Constrained mindset is generally those people that are very process oriented. There are rules. There are steps. There are processes that need to be observed. And if I want to go from A to Z, I can do that. I can embark on that journey to go to Z. I want to get to Z. But for a constrained mindset individual, I need to go to B, deal with B, then go to C, then D, and then E, F, G, H, I, J, K, L, M, N, O, P. Well, those are pretty easy, but I went through them. Step by step, I went through them and I addressed them and we did that. And then as I get to the end, okay, I had to contend with X and Y maybe a little bit, but guess what? I made it to Z. I went through the process. Order, process, rules. Okay? Now, you can clearly have... No, I don't want to say that. There are those that wish to believe that you are one or the other. But that's not true. I do not believe that's true. We all have both constrained value sets, ideologies, and unconstrained value sets within our brain. Our hardwiring simply dictates which one is dominant. Okay, memes, this day and age, these past couple years, but especially 2021, memes on social media can be incredible because, yes, they're funny. Yes, they're fun to watch, but there is so much information. I mean, serious, hardcore, fundamental truth that can be brought forth in a meme in a funny way that captures the attention. All right? What was my point? I just lost my train of thought. Sorry. Let me just jump forward unless you make it. So on this circle, let's just do this. It's going to help clarify things. On this circle, I'm going to draw a horizontal line. All right? Dash, large, just kind of a large dash horizontal line right through the middle of the circle. Okay? Come on here. Get my pen to work. All right. For those that are looking at this, they're like, gee, that looks like a tactical reticle. No, that's not what I'm trying to go for, okay? When you look at the circle, if you draw that heavy dashed horizontal line, Thomas Sowell in his book goes through the constrained versus unconstrained. And generally speaking, I don't want to put this. I'm just going to do this. I'm just going to manipulate it. I'm just going to I'm just going to change the board. Generally speaking, on this upper half, constrained. On the lower half, unconstrained. All right. So I just wrote that on the board vertically. On the side. Oops. There we go. So he talks about if you were looking at a political ideology, generally speaking, it's pretty accurate to say constrained individuals often find themselves being more conservative. And more unconstrained individuals or people that their brain is dominated by... now I know what it was about. Dang it. All right, the meme. I lost my train of thought on a meme. Okay, I said in your brain you have both constrained and unconstrained, and I jumped to the meme, and I was going to use a meme analogy, and I completely blanked it. Here's what it was. Meme comes out, and it talks about the wolf inside each of us, and this old, whether it's true or not, I don't know, but this old parable and this tale of whether it was a indigenous person was talking to an elder or whatever, and they were saying there's two wolves in each one of us. And in this case, our wolf, shall we say, is one of them is constrained and one of them is unconstrained in the mindset. Ends justify the means, unconstrained, more conservative rules, order process is constraint. Those two wolves are in our brain and they're constantly battling back and forth. And the question was, well, which one wins? And the answer is, whichever one you feed. All right? So in our brain, okay, so I'm back on track. Whew. Boy, you know, if you're not a content creator, you have no idea how getting off your train of thought can be just absolutely just crush you. You're like, oh no. Because being in a flow state is good. It's awesome. But I was off. I bounced off the rails there and I tumbled into the ditch for a little bit. We're back up. We're back up and we're moving. So unconstrained and constrained mindsets. Generally constrained is those that are associated more maybe with the thought processes that are more rules-based, more process-based, more conservative-minded individuals versus unconstrained mindset, more ends justify the means type of people. All right? We both have that in our brains. We both have elements of that. It all depends on which one of those mindsets is dominant across multiple economics, religion, relationships, money, But you pick any topic of your life that is meaningful in your life, you can start to figure out how your brain wraps itself around that topic and what you hold dear. For instance, there's a lot of conservatives that are like, no, the rule of law must be held. We need to have police. We need to have order. There needs to be a process. There needs to be a right way and wrong way of doing things. There absolutely, we're order, 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 process, 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 order, order, process. Uh-huh. Man walks into your house, ties you up, decides to go over and start raping your wife, and decides they're going to go after your daughter. You get yourself untied. How unconstrained are you going to be at that point? Are you going to simply sit there and say, I need to call the police? Are you going to walk away from the activity that's going on with your wife and your daughter at that point? Are you going to try to sneak into the other room so you can dial 911 and call the police and then sit there and wait because there's law and order, right? There's a process. Bad things are happening. The police need to come. I need to call the police. I need to let the police handle it. The police will come and arrest the bad guy. Then the bad guy will go to, he'll have a trial. We'll go through the process of the trial. And then if a jury decides that he was guilty, he will go to jail. If he doesn't, if they say he wasn't guilty, or maybe some part of the process is, you know, misconstrued and he gets off and he's not prosecuted, well, that's the process. And so I'm okay with the process. Really? Is that how you are? For you uber-constrained individuals, you conservatives that just anchor their whole ideological persona around rules and order and process, are you going to maintain a constrained mindset when your family's in danger? Or are you going to absolutely fundamentally just go straight to unconstrained and I will do everything I can do to kill that individual and put a stop to this right now? Process and rules and order be damned. Okay, and I'm going to get to more on, I'm going to use that example here in a minute to better articulate this point. But what I'm saying right now is I drew a dashed horizontal line through this circle only to demark the general hemispheres in which ideologies play. Ends justify the means versus process, and let's have some dialogue, and let's have some order, and let's have some common, you know, not, I can't say common sense. There you go. Process, order, rules, that type of stuff. All right. Now, I've said this before in other places, and it bears to be said again. This is not my statement. I heard this from someone else, and it just became a part of who I am. When we look at the world of people and we look at ideologies, you're very clearly going to see that in many ways it comes down to two types of people. There are two types of people in this world. Those that wish to be left alone and those that refuse to. Think about that. There's those that wish to be left alone. And then there's those that refuse to. And if you think about that in your life, you know that to be true. I mean, why do we have a cliche about HOA Nazis? Homeowners Association Nazis. Nazis in the air quotes. We have those quote unquote, again, air quotes, Karens of the world that are just the busybodies walking around, looking at everybody's, all of everyone else's things, what they're doing, who they are, what are you doing? That's that right. And they're just a busybody involved in everybody else's life. Whereas there's a lot of us who say, like, I'm not harming anybody. I'm not doing anything to you. Just shut up. Move on. Just leave me alone. That is a perfect example of the constrained versus unconstrained mindset. And the reason why I drew this the way I did on this spectrum is because unconstrained is at the bottom. Constrained is at the top. But you say, yeah, Chris, but the right side of you could say that on the right side of the circle is the right-leaning ideology, and on the left side of the circle is the left-leaning ideology. Yeah, you're right. But are you telling me over here, I'm going to talk to the Christian right, You telling me you don't have busybodies in your church that have to put their nose in everyone else's business and micromanage everything that they do? What are you doing? I don't think that was right. Should you have been doing that? What are you doing there here? Do you have those quote-unquote proverbial Karens in your church that are the those that wish to be left alone, probably on the top half of the circle, versus those that refuse to? They just can't not get involved with what's going on. They want to be involved, they need to be involved, and they need to influence, and they need to put their position forward. Homeowners Association, I don't care if you're on the left side of the circle or the right side of the circle, you could be in a homeowners association, and you can have those yard Nazis that walk by and say, do you realize your kid's wagon has been overlapped on the sidewalk for 2 days now, Jim? I just want to let you know, Jim. Shut up. It's my kid's wagon. He was playing with it, left it. Well, it's covering it's on the sidewalk, Jim. You telling me doesn't matter on the left or right side of that spectrum, you don't have that type of person out there? Yes, you do. So that's why constrained and unconstrained mindset, those that wish to be left alone on top, those that refuse to on the bottom, those that ends justify the means versus those that are more process-oriented are split this way, in my mind. All right? All right. I used the analogy of a color wheel for this circle. And for me, it absolutely is a color wheel. And I think if we go through it a minute, I hope this makes sense to you as well. So if we go I'm going to start drawing colors around this wheel. And there's going to be a relevant point behind it here in a minute. But I'm going to start drawing colors around this wheel. And I hope this makes sense. If we go down at the far bottom of this wheel, maybe if this was a clock, we would say 5:30 to 6:30 position. I'm going to paint that in black. That's black. And quite honestly, again, if you think about a color wheel, this is a spectrum. So. The bottom edge for me is black. The center bullseye of the circle is white. If we think about colors, it's going to be important here in a minute. We think about colors in the spectrum of light. White is, if you talk about an additive color saturation, it's all the colors of the spectrum all piled in. It's all the light piled in on top of one another, and it's just brilliantly white light. Black ends up being the absence of all colors from an additive standpoint. I believe that's correct. I may be wrong on that, but from an additive color spectrum, additive color saturation type additive deal, I think that's correct. Black is at the 5:30 to 6:30 position on the outer edge of the circle. A circle in the middle of, a small circle in the middle of the larger circle, a bullseye, if you will, in the middle of the circle is brilliant white. And then if we go around this edge, you think about it, let's just go ahead and say left versus right. Excuse me. Well, left versus right, we generally consider the right to be red, right? Red states versus blue states, conservative versus liberal states. So let's go ahead and do that. Let's go ahead over here on the right side. Let's just paint that maybe red. That's going to be red over here somewhere. And then over here on the left side, we're going to make... this is blue. So at the 9 o'clock position, it's blue. At the 3 o'clock position, it's red. At the 6 o'clock position, it's black. At the center of the disc is brilliant white. If you start to think about the spectrum of colors, you can say, well, between red and black, you're going to have a different... You're going to go from red to maybe a dark red. Right? You're going to go to maybe a darker red. And then maybe somewhere down in there, you're going to get this deep maroon color. Okay? And I don't know if this is going to work. I'm going to try to... Maybe it's going to be a deep maroon color down there. Okay? I know that's not quite, but anyway, just imagine I don't have a maroon. I only have certain colors on my dry erase. But at 3 o'clock, you've just got your bright red. At maybe 4 o'clock, you've got a deep red and a darker red. At about 5 o'clock, you start getting into that deep burgundy maroon color to where by the time you get down to that 5:30 position, that red is bleeding into black. It's just getting darker and darker. But as we go forward up above, and same thing on the left side of the spectrum. So here's, I've got purple. So purple, we're going to say, is dark. You start getting to a deeper blue. And then... likewise, you can have a less color blue or a medium dark blue to where at the 9 o'clock position on that disc, we're going to say it's bright blue. At about the 8 o'clock position, it's a deep blue indigo. We start getting down to the 7 o'clock position. Now we're starting to get into that deep indigo purple, just dark, and as by the time you just bottom out at the bottom end of that circle, it's going from this deep purple into black. All right? But if we continue on the spectrum, what we end up with, what's the other primary color we're in here? Yellow, right? We need to have yellow. Yellow ends up being at the 12 o'clock position. All right? Yellow's at the 12 o'clock. If we go over on the right side, if you start going between red and yellow, you're going to basically start getting into, and I'm just going to make this in one. I don't need to try to separate it. You get the idea. Between red and yellow, between 1 o'clock and 2 o'clock, somewhere in there, between noon, 12 o'clock and 3 o'clock, you're going to have this gradation of going from yellow into yellowish orange to reddish orange to where at 3 o'clock you're just full on red. But the same thing goes over on the left-hand side of the spectrum. You go from yellow to blue, what do you end up with? Green, right? Mixing those colors. So again, here we go. We go from the top of 12 o'clock and we rotate around to the 9 o'clock position. We go from this yellow-green to this Kelly green to this blue-green to we just end up into blue. And I want... Again, this is just how I think of things, and this is how I visualize it. Dead black and night at the bottom of this circle at 6 o'clock. Bright, brilliant white in the middle of the center of this circle. Blue, oftentimes attributed to left-leaning ideology. Blue states versus red states, right? On the left side, where we've got more blue tones across the spectrum. But you also realize that you can be on the left side of the spectrum, and if you're in the upper left quadrant of the circle, you're not really blue-ish. You're on the blue side, but you're really more in the green. You've got blue in you, but as you move away from the black, and you move away from the other end of the spectrum, the unconstrained side of the spectrum, if you move away from the 6 o'clock position and you go towards the 12 o'clock position, you're losing more and more blue. You're still, if you're on the left side of the spectrum, you still have blue in you. But you're a different gradation of blue. Up here towards the top near the yellow, you have a tiny, tiny little bit of blue. If you're over here at the 845 point, position over here, okay, you're blue. You're brilliant blue. Same thing on the right side. You might be red. You're like, oh, I'm on the right side. I'm politically on the right side. Okay, you are. But where are you? Are you like uber red? Are you down in this, you know, lower right quadrant, the southeast quadrant of that circle? Are you like dark blue, maroon blue, or art and blue, red? Are you dark red? Are you bright red? Are you dark red? Are you a maroon red going on here? Or really, you're red-ish. You have red in you, but the further you go away from this black, and the further you go up on that circle, you have red in you, you just have less and less of it. You're still on the red side, but you just don't have much. This is where this line, this vertical, in my mind, this vertical line starts that I drew from the circle, from the bottom of the circle, solid moving up, and then dash, 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 da, 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 and it stops in the middle. Because the more you go from, if you start at the middle and the further you go to the edge downward, the more intense your color saturation is. Red versus blue. The further you go away from the bottom half of the circle and you start going to the north half, the top half of the circle, the less saturation you have red versus blue. And I'm meaning that figuratively from the general society idea, you know, identification of, you know, if you're a conservative, you're red. You're red state. If you're a liberal, you're blue state. Okay? To what degree? All right? And if you think about it, the other reason why I put this the way it does, I'm just going to make no bones about it. Black has always been, when we look through cinematic history and other, you know, literature and everything else, the villain always wears black. And white is always the good guys, right? Generally speaking. This is going to come up to be very important here in a minute. Black is here at the bottom of the circle. And it represents a very tiny chunk of that circle. White, brilliant white. White light so brilliant you can't even look at it. Is right here in the middle of the circle. I'm going to say why I believe that here in a minute. All right. Crap. When we start talking about people fitting in this spectrum, I know what I'm going to do. I drew my circle in the middle of the board, and I didn't leave myself room. To talk about something else. So what I'm going to do right now is I'm going to flip my board upside down. Because I know I have room at the top of it. I don't think I have room at the bottom of it. So I'm going to leave room at the top. I'm going to use the room. So I'm going to flip my board upside down. So my circle now is upside down and it's at the bottom half of the board. But I've got a chunk of real estate at the top of the board that I can draw on. If we look back in our, I'm going to scare you. We're going to go back to our days of statistics and probability curves and all that type of stuff. If we go back to our standard bell-shaped curve, okay? Remember that? Standard bell-shaped curve from statistics and wherever. I guess you got the upper axis and lower axis. Let's just do this right, Chris. Bam, bam. Okay, you got your x-axis and y-axis on there, and then in there is a standard bell-shaped curve. If we remember back to... gonna cut you off right now, all you little critics. I'm not saying that the numbers I'm gonna throw up here are directly related to exactly what demographics and polling data show. I don't know. I'm using this as a generality, so you can frame your conceptualization of this idea around it in a way that I believe is largely accurate. Plus or minus, I don't know. It's largely accurate. So if we remember back to when we were talking about the standard bell-shaped curve, right? If you look at where almost 70% ends up being like 68% of the population, where the vast majority of people, no, what it is, let me just read it. And this one I got from NYU, their statistics place. If I looked at this portion, the center portion, the big fat portion of that curve, the statement is about 68% of the time, 68% of the time, a randomly chosen observation, a randomly happened upon instance, a randomly happened upon individual will fall their what we're talking about right now, ideology, their ideology will fall within this chunk of the curve. The fat bulk part of the curve, right smack in the middle, roughly 70% of your population is going to be right there. Whereas, if we go out one more, and we talk about standard deviations, right? Okay, we go out one more to the right, one more to the left. I just drew that in green. So in the red, actually, let me spell this out. In the red, let's just say 68%. In the green, two standard deviations. In the green, 95, within two standard deviations, a randomly happened upon individual, a randomly happened upon event, can be found within two standard deviations of the mean, the center of this. We'll just do that in blue. The dead center. Oh, I've got it in my hand. The dead center. Point, 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 point. Okay, the dead center of that curve. Go out from the center, one standard deviation, that's red. You go out two standard deviations from that center, and that's green. Red encompasses about 70% of the population. Green encompasses 95% of the population. So if you randomly happen upon somebody out there, 95% of the time, they're going to be in that green zone, all right? But you do have, I'm sorry to say, you do have, what color do I want to use for these guys? I don't know. I guess I can use blue. You have that 2.5% that's way the heck on the uber far right side of this of the bell-shaped curve, and you've got that uber far postmodern leftist progressive socialist communist on the far left side of the curve. 2.5%, 2.5%. Tiny chunk of the population. Again, I don't care if these numbers are identical or they are actually 100% factual. I'm just sharing the general broad idea because I believe this to be true. I believe that when we go out across the landscape and we engage one another, not online, I'm talking about in person at the grocery store, at the gas station, at our church, at our gym, at our school, I believe that almost 70% of the time we're dealing with these people that are just, they're flipping, they're right around the middle. They're just center, okay? Within their ideology, they're centralized in their ideology. They believe a little left, they believe a little right, whatever, that's good, but they're in the middle. Then you have this next group, all right? This next group here in green. You have it on both sides of the curve. In green, you have those people that live in that realm They are mostly right-leaning. Then you have those people on the left side of the spectrum that are green, in that green second standard deviation, where they say, I'm mostly left-leaning. All right? So I wanted to share that because I truly believe that directly translates, and I'm going to flip this back over, onto this circle. All right? The bell-shaped curve, in my opinion, translates onto this circle. Let me put my pens back up here a minute. No certain order. I truly believe that we can, on this ideological circle, we can paint those standard deviations in colors, not colors, standard deviations on this circle. So, again, how do we want to do it? Do we want to do it in... Let's try a different color. Let's do... Well, there would have been... All right. I don't know. I'm trying to do this to where I know where it's going to show up. Nope. I'm just going to do it this way. I'm going to do on the left. All right. So, the left side of the spectrum. Okay? If we look at 68% of the population in that center portion, was that 34% on the left and 34% on the right? Okay? So, if we take a line coming down here, blue. I'm going to draw a dashed blue line from 12 o'clock to the brilliant white center. And then I'm just going to eyeball it. If half of this is 50%, so half of a circle is 50%, okay? Then this quarter circle is 25%. And if we're looking at trying to say 34%, right? Let's just eyeball it and say this here. Okay, I'm making a dashed blue line from the brilliant white center to, say, the 8 o'clock position. And if you look within that upper left pie from 12 o'clock to 8 o'clock, there is your 34% left. Right? But likewise... We can go and say, on the right, I'm going to start at 12 o'clock and I'm going to fill in between the blue lines. I'm going to put red. So between 12 o'clock and the brilliant white center is a red and blue dashed line. And then again, as we go on the right-hand side, we can have 34% of the people on the within that one standard deviation on the right side of the mean, 34%. I'm going to draw a dashed line to, again, essentially, I'm going to change that, essentially the 4 o'clock position. Oh, I didn't let it dry. Christopher, that's a bummer. I made a smudge, and that's a bummer. I didn't let it dry. That's the only thing about dry erase things. All right, so if I go to the 4 o'clock position, dash line to... essentially the 4 o'clock position. All right, there we go. Now you kind of got this peace sign in the middle from left and right. So the 34%. Right? Right versus left. 34. All right, so that's within one standard deviation. And I believe this to be true, or very, very close to being true, that the vast majority of the population lies here. Many people reside above... Hold on. Telling you, I can get ahead of myself. All right, so that's one standard deviation. But then you can have that That next standard deviation, which is what? 13.5%? Isn't that what it is? I think that's what it is. And I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to do this dash line in black. And I'm going to basically tie it in to this black line down here. Start from the brilliant white center. And I'm going to make a dash line down to the bottom where I have it painted black. Same thing on the right-hand side. I'm going to go from the brilliant white center, dash line, down to where I have it painted black. It was not equal. Let me fix it. Don't want people yelling at me. Okay. So there's your black. On either side of that, 2.5, 2.5. All right. This combined is about 5%. So the black portion comprises about 5% of that disk space. On the left, I'll do it in purple. I think this is about 13.5 if my math is right. Oops. If I remember correctly. Yeah, 13.5. Did that in purple because it's getting in that purple realm. You're getting really, really saturated in how much blue you have as you approach black. And then on the other side, again, I don't have a burgundy, but we're just going to go, you know what, I'll use purple as representing both sides. Just understand that this is like a burgundy maroon color, okay? And I can, all right, so there we go, burgundy, maroon, whatever. I truly fundamentally believe this to be correct. Roughly 70% of the population lie 68%. We could probably say it's almost 70% of the population. No, 50% of the population lies above that horizontal line in the constrained and unconstrained mindset realm. You have a portion, and then you do. You have that 13.5. You have a smaller subset of people that absolutely fundamentally live in the far left hemisphere, ideological plane in their brain. Like you have a smaller chunk of people that are absolutely in the uber far right. They are far right. You know, we don't have, it gets thrown around to whether it's religious right or the Christian right or whatever. It doesn't matter. These are the right wing fundamentalists that these are. I lean right, damn it. Okay? But then you have these little suckers. This sliver of 2.5%, those extremes on both sides. What do you notice here? They're in the same damn area of the circle, aren't they? Because ideologically, they are. If we look at how this ideology plays out, it's as you get into this black, this is where ideology becomes totalitarian. Again, unconstrained mindset. Ends justify the means. You do whatever is necessary to achieve your goals. On the right side of the spectrum, of the circle, it is rules, order, process, right? When you look at that, fascism, people sit there and say, oh, fascism, we need to be, you know, anti-fascism, we need anti-Nazi, blah, 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 blah. Or more accurately, what you hear people talking about these days is about anti-nationalism, these white nationalists, and all these fascists, blah, 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 blah. What they're saying actually does exist. You can have, there are a segment of the population that believe national identity, national national preservation, national preservation is key. Whether we're talking about the sovereignty, the nation, the identity of a nation, all the, you can absolutely have authoritarian right-wing regimes. But what does that mean? They're authoritarian. Ends justify the means. They will do whatever the hell they need to necessitate the realization of their goals. Oftentimes by deadly force. Right? That's what you want to, the folks on the left want to rail against fascism. Nationalism. Especially white nationalists. Right? Remember when I drew this hard line right here at the bottom? And then it kind of goes dash, 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 and it starts to kind of fade away and then it disappears into that brilliant white center. Because there is a hard line right here at the bottom. Nationalists, the uber tiny chunk of the population that believe in authoritarian rule for a nationalist perspective, make up a tiny little chunk of the pie. But that tiny little chunk of the pie is at the far bottom of that pie. That circle. Right on the other side of that hard wall are the socialists and the communists. The postmodern leftist progressive ideology and those that want to actually impart socialism and communism. On one side, on the right side, it is about national identity and national preservation. Ends justify the means. On the left side of this is that uber small group that is about the people. It's about the socialism. And I don't care if you want to talk about democratic socialism or just flat social. Democratic socialism is right here on the edge of the deep purple where it disappears in the black. All you're doing is you're voting yourself into that black portion of the circle. Here, it's still authoritarian rule. It's still top-down by force rule. It's, but it's, in this case, it's quote unquote for the people. But you're still under an unconstrained, the epitome, the pit and the most extreme manifestation of an unconstrained mindset of ends justify the means. We will do whatever the damn well we want to in order to get where we need to go. Remember my talk about in the beginning, A to Z. We need to be at Z. These guys, we don't give a crap in the world how we get there. If we stumble, trip, fall, steamroll, kill, slaughter, whatever. We're going to damn well get to this portion and we're going to force our ideology. Because on this side, we're more enlightened, we're smarter, we know better, blah, 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 blah. From an altruistic standpoint. Same thing, though, goes on this other side of the equation. With a lot of other people, a lot of, especially, it doesn't, no one likes to be told that they're down in this region of the pie. But you know what? Some of you are. Even on the right-hand side. You can have people that say, we need rule and order. We need law. We need to have borders. We need to have an English language. We need to have this. We need it. And you want to force that in by law, this, that, and the other thing. And why, damn it, we're going to achieve nationalism by ends, by all means necessary, even if we'd have to do it by force. Because it's better for the nation. And it's better for everybody as a whole. Remember what I said in the beginning. The horizontal line. Left on the left. Right on the right. Everybody wants to talk about left versus right from a horizontal perspective. Because it takes the left side of the argument, the totalitarian ideology of the left, and puts it as far away from the right side of the totalitarian ideology of the right. They're polar opposites, supposedly, right? No. It's not a spectrum, or it's not a linear line. It's not a horizontal line. It is a circle. You can go all the way, you can start at 6 o'clock and go clockwise around the circumference of that circle and come back to 6 o'clock. Yes, that, as far as epitome of ideology, is far apart. If we go all the way around the circumference of the circle, yes, that's a long distance. But functionally, it's not. You're still between 5:30 and 6:30 on the dial. You're right here. You're in the same freaking plane. You're right there across. All you are is one side of the same coin. You are on the same side. You are on. You have the authoritarian coin, and you're just two opposite sides of it. But look at how much of the pie is left. How much more ideology is in that circle? A lot. So again, if we go at the top, I know I'm jumping ahead, man. Sorry. Oh, here's another one. Okay, so real quick. We can take this 13.5%, and this one would hit me, and I was kind of trying to wrap my head around it. Constrained mindset. Generally more bound in your brains by process. You believe there's a right and wrong way to do things. You just fundamentally believe in right and wrong. And damn it, I want things to be right. Sometimes they're not. But there needs to be some sort of process. There needs to be some sort of order. More order. Well, and I don't want to say, hold on. Because this turned out, this came up as well. And I may save this for another conversation. Order versus chaos. Top half of that circle, generally from an ideologic standpoint, and that's probably 50% of the population, right? Because this would be 70%, right? From the red going up and around over to the blue, you're talking about 70% of the population. So let's just say this represents roughly 50% of the population. Generally, and I truly believe this, generally understands that there's law and order, there's rules and regulations, and it should strive for some semblance of better functioning society, stable functioning society. But you do see where you can be in the blue side, and in that small little section of the pie on the blue side that falls below the horizontal dashed line of unconstrained versus constrained demarcation, you can have people that are the vast majority of people that lean to the left. There's going to be a segment of their ideology that does dip into an unconstrained mindset where, you know what? We generally believe that law, order, rules, orderly function of society needs to be maintained and should be preserved. But sometimes Rosa Parks needs to just not go to the back of the bus. Sometimes Gandhi just needs to sit up or just sit himself down and say, no, I'm not moving. I'm not going to do that. All right? So there are going to be times on the left where this person that embraces this general ideology that is in the majority of their representative public does embrace some unconstrained behavior. Or ideology and acceptance, shall we say. Ends justify the means acceptance. The same thing goes over here as well on the right. You can sit there and say, I'm a conservative. Yes, you are. You are a conservative. Okay, good for you. But there are some conservatives, and there's a chunk of that population in that little pie that falls below that unconstrained demarcation to where, no, sometimes ends justify the means. What do I mean? There are some people that believe that, yeah, we should legislate and outlaw abortion. We know that the Supreme Court ruled in one way. We went through the process. Roe versus Wade, all the other things. Go down your rabbit hole of your conservative ideology on abortion. Are you happy with the process as it unfolded? The process was righteous. righteous as the process can be within the United States. Some of you are not. Some are not. And some vehemently advocate that we need to have laws. We need to change the law to make sure we effectuate our value set in getting rid of abortion. Ends justify the means. The process didn't work the way we wanted it to do, so scrap the process and let's just make a law. So we want to vote some president in or a senator or whatever that's going to come into office and they're going to make the law. They're going to change Roe v. Wade. You know darn well on your right side, you absolutely believe that. Now, granted, again, we get down in these little, the 13 and a half slivers. These are people that are just, yep, yeah. I want, we're going to nationalize the language that everything has to be English. We're going to shut down the borders and no one comes in ever again, blah, 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 blah. We can have right wing, all sorts of other stuff. Just like we can have on the left wing, there should be no borders, open them up. We bring all those people in that they want to, blah, 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 blah. But if you start to look at this a little bit more visually, you can see that this ideology at the bottom, this unconstrained ideology, the farther we dive into it, the deeper we go into it. It does not matter if we're on the right or left. We get into a very, very dark place. And our enemy is not that polar opposite. They're literally the same damn people. One just wants to argue for on behalf of the national identity. The other one wants to argue it on behalf of the social betterment of society. They're the same damn piece of evil, as far as I'm concerned. The closer you get to the center, the brighter the light. And I'm going to talk about that here coming up. And I might need to kill this one here for a second. And I think I will. I think I'll break this up into two parts. The other thing I want to say, and this I do believe is important here for this discussion. If we're looking on this spectrum, like I said in the beginning, people I will get into it. Two things. People are not just a point on this. I've got a lot of writing on here and I don't want to confuse it, but I'm just going to do this a minute. Okay. I'm going to put a person here, a point here, and yeah, no. Hold on. I'm going to put a point here, kind of centrally located in the upper right quarter of the circle. And then I'm going to put a point here that's over on the left upper quadrant of the circle. So I've got an individual that's on the left and he's kind of leaning farther on the left. And then I have a person on the right that's just kind of just centrally located. And both of these are above the constrained, unconstrained mindset line. So many people talking today want you to believe that the people that you're engaging in your life, in policy, social media are a point. They're just this one singular point on the map. Somewhere in here, they're just a point. Maybe they're just a point down here. Maybe they're a point here. Maybe they're a point here. They're just a point on the circle within the spectrum. I mean the color spectrum here. I'm not the ideological spectrum. I'm not talking about the autistic spectrum. I'm talking about the ideological spectrum that's represented here. There's so many people that want to make you a point, a singular point. Because if you lie, let's just say this upper vertical line, this blue red dash line up here that demarcates just by default left versus right. If you are right on the edge of the left of that line versus right on the edge of the right side of that line, you're the enemy. Well, you're on the right, you're on the left. Screw you, you're just as bad as these people down here. That's what's being portrayed right now. I'm going to talk about how we play, how I understand and I visualize how people and how we all play within this ideological spectrum in the next video. But for right now, I don't want you to believe that people are a point on this spectrum. They're not. Like Thomas Sowell outlines in his book, A Conflict of Visions. And like I said in the beginning, we all have components of constrained versus unconstrained mindset. Regardless of whether we're on the left side of the political spectrum, ideological spectrum, or on the right. It all depends on the topic that we are talking about. And so earlier I gave the example. I can be a conservative. And maybe there's all sorts. Thomas Sowell goes through all sorts of stuff in his book, and he makes a brilliant case: finances, religion, economics, and how you, all sorts of things. But let's just say, arbitrarily, let's just say we pick. There's this one here. I call them ideological tendrils. If for no better reason of visualizing this, you may have all sorts of things that go on in your life. And quite honestly, all these things that you think about, process, believe, they have. Again, we're talking about color wheel, so I'm using these tendrils to go. In my previous example, I may be a conservative-minded individual that's not right-wing. I'm generally process-oriented. I'm generally lean to the political right side of the spectrum, so the ideological right side of the spectrum, but I'm not in the unconstrained mindset field. I generally, the vast majority, if you look at these tendrils, these are things that you deal with in your life. These are the things that you engage with in your life, that you think about in your life, that you develop a value set for your life, that guide how you act on the landscape. Most of your little ideological tendrils, of all those little things, lie within this quadrant up here in the constrained mindset, all but one. And then other ones, most of the ones reside on that left side of the the right side of the spectrum. But actually, maybe I've got a couple things that I believe that generally cross over into the left side of the spectrum. Maybe as a conservative, I really don't care about gay marriage, really. You know what? I don't know. Maybe I don't. Maybe over here, gay marriage is not that big of a deal because, quite honestly, you know, if we wanted to think about it, maybe the states and government shouldn't have been involved with marrying people anyway. And once that got out of the religious front, we can make all sorts of arguments of why maybe marriage has gotten out of the Christian right world anyway. So at this point, there's bigger fish to fry. I don't give a crap if someone wants to get married. Nah, my ideology, maybe it reaches over into the left side of the spectrum. The bulk of my ideology resides over here, but I have one, maybe two things that reach over into the left side of the spectrum. And again, the example I gave with the family. If someone walks into your house and starts killing your spouse or raping your child, maybe you actually live way up here in this conservative constrained world, but that tendril goes all the way down to the deepest, darkest, nastiest pit of frickin' I'll do whatever the hell needs to happen in order for me to save my spouse or my child. Make sense? The bulk of your ideology lives here, but you will have tendrils that reach into different portions of this. The same thing is true for the other side. The other side. Okay? Just because you might be uber leftist or way over, not leftist, uber liberal, very liberal, leaning very close to the bright blue side of the spectrum, the vast majority of your tendrils might all reside in here. And quite honestly, you might actually have one or two that reach into that unconstrained mindset realm. But I can tell you, there are a lot of people where that ideology crosses. Eric Weinstein did a great job talking with David Rubin and Jordan Peterson about this, about how he's literally, he is a leftist. Apologies. He's a liberal, maybe leaning leftist liberal, but he's a liberal, passionate about it. But the craziness that's going on down here, and we're going to talk about some of the skewing here in a little bit. The craziness that's going on here and the draining of the beneficial parts of society that's draining into this has caused him to say, no, damn it. We do need, I do value this. I do value some of these areas over here. And he's actually got a lot of, maybe one, two more, I don't know how many tendrils, ideological tendrils that cross what other people would consider that ideological boundary from left versus right. Just because you see someone on the other, quote unquote, on this other vertical line, again, the vertical line separating left versus right, just because you see someone engaging or actively living in that environment does not mean they don't have those tendrils that go out across there cross-pollination. They intersect, all right? And here's why. How do I want to put this? You can have, I'll just say it and I might reiterate it. Thomas Sowell talks about the hardwiring. Oh, shoot. I'll talk about that here in a second, too. This is going to be a longer video. I apologize. Bear with me. We all have the reason why we can have this commingling, this intersection, and this cross-pollination, because we all have the big five personality traits are pretty universal across everyone. We all might have different personalities, but we also can have a lot of similar personalities. But likewise, influence on our lives is also from life experiences. And different life experiences can end up putting us in different places on this ideological spectrum. But we very well might have similar life experiences. And I'll just say it now. I have it in a different slide and it'll come up for my notes, but I'm going to just jump ahead. We can have similar personalities, big five trait personalities. We might be very similar, but our life experiences drastically different. And we might end up on that ideological spectrum in two different places, but our personalities are the same. What does that mean? There's a currency there in which we can communicate if we just tune into it. Similarly, or I guess conversely, however you want to, whatever frame of reference you want to look into, we can have wildly different personalities, but we might have the exact same life experience. Again, that's going to change, or it can manifest itself within each of those individuals by placing them in a different spot on this ideological spectrum. But what's important about that? If we take time to know that, there's another chance for communication. We might have different personalities, and that's going to be a challenge in communication. However, if we find out that we have a similar life experience, that's at least some grounding that we can come from. But the only way that we're going to know that is if we're in tune with the reality that we are not a point on a spectrum. These ideological tendrils in our lives reach out across this entire circle. And you will have cross, you know, intersections with other people. And that's a good thing, because those are the places where you can start to have a dialogue. We might be wildly different where we live on this map, but at least if there's an intersection there, we can at least identify it, and hopefully we can have a dialogue. I know, I just jumped ahead a little bit, but oh well. Oh, okay. Yes, I brought up the order and chaos briefly, and I wasn't sure I wanted to go into it, and yes, I did. Yeah, I forgot I did. Dr. Peterson talks about order and chaos all the time, yin and yang. If you look at the yin and yang symbol, you've got a black portion, you've got a white portion that are wrapped around each other. One side has a larger black portion, one side has a larger white portion, opposing colors. One side's larger, but the tail of white has a larger head, but it's got a skinny tail. But the skinny tail of the white portion wraps around and touches and relates into and marries into and nests into the black portion. And then when within that, there's a little spot, a little dot within the black that's white, and within the white that's black, the yin and yang, order versus chaos. Ancient idea. He talks about it all the time in his lectures, in his book, 12 Rules for Life. Brilliant. So much good information that he talks about regarding that symbolism right there. And if we look at this pie chart, not pie chart, this spectrum, this ideological spectrum, this color wheel, this is order at the bottom. Ultimate order. Totalitarian, authoritarian, total control. The 2.5% on the right side of the spectrum is for nationalism, national identity, blah, 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 blah. The 2.5% on the left side is socialism, communism, collectivism. That's a better way to put it. National identity is more important. Collective identity is more important. Collective identity on the left, national identity on the right. The bottom black portion that, again, I put it at the bottom because it is the deepest, darkest pit of despair down here in human history. It always has been. It always will be because of personalities and in human nature. We can't do anything about it. It always ends into this pit blackness. If this is the uber, and I know there's some confusing here. If this is the uber end of all order, the ultimate of all order, and the ultimate of order would be chaos. All right. If we took the polar opposite of this and went to the top up in that yellow, maybe some would argue, well, that's where anarchists live. That's where the libertarians live. This is ultimate control by government at the bottom. I don't care what side of the spectrum you're on. Your ideology is ultimate authoritarian control. Well, the opposite would be up here of no control. I haven't fleshed that out. I don't know if we can make this argument that the yellow portion at 12 o'clock is anarchy. If it's libertarianism, I don't know. I don't know. But that is one thing that I have not fleshed out yet. Let's just put it that way. Because it comes up and it's a part of this. I haven't figured out the puzzle piece perfectly and where it fits. But I'm just going to put that out there. Maybe one of you can look at it, think about it, and see if that makes sense. Ultimate order in the actuation of a political ideology, where does chaos lie? At this point, by default, it's up here. The 2.5% up here at 12, between 11:30 and 12:30 on the face of the clock, the dial. But here's the thing, the important part, and I brought this up a minute ago. If you look at this 68%, 70% of the population, there's a lot of bleed over. Again, that's why I didn't make a hard line all the way up to the top from the bright, brilliant center to the top of the circle. It's nebulous because there's a lot of ideological bleed over in this area. And there's a lot of people in this chunk of the, just even the one standard deviation, roughly 70% of the population, I truly believe lies in the realm of the vast majority of their thought processes. There should be rule and order. There's a right and wrong way to do things. We can have a healthy debate on how we live in this upper hemisphere of this circle. Whether we lean on the right, whether we lean on the left, but there should be room for healthy debate up in this neck of the woods, because these two portions touch one another and have very similar relationships in their ideology. When you get down to the leftists, what I would call that 13.5% period on the left, the leftists, the especially the postmodern progressive leftists, these people and the far right people, they're getting closer in some of their ideology. But again, if we're talking about the distance, we're talking about going around that color wheel. Because again, we've got this dividing line here on the bottom. As we're approaching this bright, brilliant center, maybe there's not as much of a demarcation in there. Maybe, and I don't know this to be true. I might be completely wrong. This just came to me. Maybe you have someone that lives in this uber right wing 13.5% that although their ideology and how they come about it might be wrong, their intent is good. Maybe their tactics and how they frame their mindset is wrong, but maybe the intent and the notion behind what they're trying to achieve is righteous. Maybe they are closer to the center, that brilliant white center of this pie, of this color spectrum. Which means you can see at that close, that dotted line between those ideologies is a tiny little dotted line. The hardened wall between them is not that great. Obviously, we get towards the edge down this pit of black, nasty despair of authoritarian control. There is a hard line it's a hard wall that separates the two of them, where they're probably not going to talk. They're probably not going to reach common ground. But you could have a leftist. Maybe you have a progressive ideology. Maybe it's not a postmodern progressive ideology. Maybe it's just a progressive ideology. You are a leftist-ish. You truly believe that this side, the left side of the spectrum, is righteous. You just have developed, because of your personality and your life experiences, it has put you in this 13.5% pie down here towards that 6:30 and 7:30 framework or whatever, 8:30 framework, 8 o'clock framework, whatever it is. Your tactics about how you believe things should be done might be wrong or not healthy for everyone else, but you reside up towards the intent and the rationality and the reasoning for that belief lies closer to that brilliant white center of the dial, of the spectrum. Again, you might be polar opposites as far as you guys believe you are. But if you share the same freaking goal and you have the same intent, righteous intent, maybe you in fact are closer up here. The dotted line between you is not that hardened. You might have communication between you. Does that make sense? I don't know. And I said this before, personality. So also, Thomas Sowell talks about, oh, for Pete's sake. Do I want to? Yes. I'm gonna talk about two more things and we're gonna kill it and I'll I know this is long. Hardwiring. No, that's my segue. Hold on. I'm gonna switch this baby around. All right, one last thing on this. Temporarily last thing on this, then I'm gonna grab another visual. Like I said before, personality and life experiences can be similar and different, but they can overlap. You can have similar personalities with someone on a completely different ideological spectrum as you, but you might have different life experiences. You might have the exact same life experience, but your personality puts you and another person on a completely different portion of this ideological spectrum. What I don't know is where Thomas Sowell's, what I interpreted with Thomas Sowell and his idea and his concept of the hardwire, how the brain is hardwired, that's what I got, how the brain is hardwired, versus how personality and life experiences intersect. In my mind, I have come up with a visual that I do not know if is right. I'm putting up, I switched, so those that are just still listening, you're probably going nuts right now because you're frantically clicking over to the video section because the video is going to make it, I hope, a lot easier to understand. For me, personality and life experiences are critical in understanding where people are coming from and how they intersect with ourselves. But that ideology still stems from some deep hardwiring of the brain. What I don't know is which comes first. And so I'm going to, so what I've got here, I drew this earlier, and this is kind of how I envisioned this next little segue here. To clarify what I was talking about, life experiences and personality and the constrained, unconstrained mindset hardwiring. So if we look at the five traits of personality, extroversion, neuroticism, agreeableness, conscientiousness, openness, if you learn about it, you'll realize that, you know, those are the five main traits, but they all just kind of, they generally can be split into two different portions, and which then you have 10 general traits, but each of those two can be collapsed into the one. So it's either five traits, the big five personality traits that are oftentimes branched into two different traits under each one. To me, in my mind, it almost seems like our personalities grow out of the substrate of constrained, unconstrained mindset. In my opinion, it seems, in my understanding, it almost seems like our brains are, we have a proclivity for our brains to be hardwired in such a manner that our personality will grow out of that substrate into, like just from an imagery standpoint, a tree. Imagine a tree growing out of the ground. The ground is that constrained, unconstrained substrate from which our personality grows. And our life experiences, no, hold on, don't jump to, let me take a step back. Our personality grows out of that substrate of constrained, unconstrained mindset, that hardwiring. How our personalities develop and how we manifest ourselves on the landscape within our personality, if we're going to use the tree analogy, every one of our trees could be different. Maybe your personality lets you grow tall and big and strong, but maybe you're not that flexible and you're brittle and easily broken. Maybe your personality is extremely flexible. You can roll with anything that life is throwing at you. But maybe you're not that big. Maybe you're not that strong. Maybe you provide a lot of shade. Maybe you provide a lot of cover for other people. Maybe you're not. Maybe you're just your own little spindly stick growing out there. And everybody's personality manifests itself into this this thing on the landscape. If from me in my environmental biology role, I'm thinking of a tree. Your personality, some people are big sequoias, some people are oak trees, some people are willows, some people are who knows what. Pine trees and all. There's so many different trees in the world. You think about the number of tree species in the world. They're all a tree. But they're not all the same. They have their strengths and weaknesses, pluses and minuses. Some are good at bearing fruit and doing other things are providing cover and shade. Nearly the two shall meet sometimes. They're all different. Each one has its strengths on the landscape and its value in the landscape for that purpose. In my mind, I see our life experiences being the environmental factors from which our personality grows. How much rain is that getting? How much wind is it getting? How much heat is it getting? How much cold is it getting? How many outside attacks is just being pummeled upon this tree? Does this tree grow up in an environment where it gets all the nourishment it needs, all the great and glorious lazy days that it needs and beautiful growing conditions where it can grow rapidly, fast, but it's never been hit by hardship? And so where the first nasty wind comes in, it just shears that thing right off at the ground because the tree has never had to be pummeled back and forth and built resiliency and strength in the core. Did it grow? The tree could have grown massively and big and beautiful, but it was just choked out with no sun, no water, no sustenance whatsoever. The personality is there. The personality wants to be a tree. But life experiences are going to dictate how that tree looks over time. Whether a limb has gotten sheared off on it, if it got snapped off, or whether it's growing and it's doing pretty darn well. It's weathered some harsh stuff. It lost a few leaves here and there. But you know what? The hardships made me stronger, and I'm going to manifest myself into the maximum tree that I can be. This is how I think it is. How ideology comes about. It grows from the hardwire, the proclivity for the brain to hardwire itself in a constrained or unconstrained mindset. A process and order style mindset, or ends justify the means mindset. Which one do you largely embrace? How does your brain default? All right? From there, your personality, what the five traits come up, and you can see I've got them just drawn here to where two of my personality, maybe this is me, I don't know, two personality traits grow forth and come up into this tree, but two of those, each one of their roots dives into the unconstrained layer of the substrate. Whereas the other three of the big five personality traits, maybe they're rooted in more of a constrained mindset. And maybe whatever it translates, the life experiences attacked or supported or nourished or starved, however, the life experiences affected themselves on this tree, this personality, and it is going to, it's going to affect and possibly modify the visual outward expression of this tree. You can have the exact same oak tree, but two environmentally different conditions can make that tree look wildly different. Does that make sense? I hope so. Okay? This is what I believe. That personality grows out of that constrained, unconstrained mindset, and then learned behavior, life experiences affect how that tree manifests itself on the landscape. Here's the kicker of this whole discussion. Let me flip this whole thing right upside down because I don't know. I don't know. I don't know if it's 100. I don't know if my tree analogy is 100 is perfectly right or if it's 180 degrees opposite. Maybe innate personality coupled with life experiences create the substrate of the ideology. Maybe it's completely backwards. Yeah, let me really blow your mind and then let's just lay it on its side. And then let's just say, well, maybe this doesn't happen in one fell swoop. Maybe it's an ecosystem type of approach where you have the substrate, you have substrate, a personality grows, it manifests itself over time, individuals and ideologies fall off, those organic matter fall off, decompose into another substrate, and then that substrate lends itself to another iteration of personality. I don't know. I don't know if this is a, is it a feedback loop? I don't know. I really don't know. I would love to talk to somebody who thinks they have the answer, a credible somebody that has that thinks they have the answer. But for now, I'm going to put this baby right back, right side up. And I, in my brain now, believes that that hardwiring is the substrate from which a personality grows. And the life experiences are what we, what translate into being, what we see within each other when we engage them. And the big part about that is when we engage them. With the tree analogy, we can have, let's just say, these ideological tendrils. Say those are the branches of our personality and the branches of our tree and the branches of our life experiences, and they reach across and they intersect with someone else. If we don't know that, how will we know that we have an opportunity for dialogue? How do we know that we don't have similarities there that we're overlooking? If we allow the convention, the current climate, social climate and social dialogue to persist, making it seem as though we are simply on a horizontal line, and anybody who's on the other half of that line is an enemy that has nothing to do with us. We're completely different. We're wildly different individuals, and we cannot have a we cannot, you know, come together because you're wrong and I'm right. I'm righteous in my belief. And you're wrong and evil. We're done. If we continue that idea, that mindset, we're done. What frightens me is this. That mindset's completely wrong. It's BS. This monstrosity that I drew, this is right. I know it to be right. I can't prove it to be right. It is right from everything that I've learned and interpreted and understood. I don't know if I have the exact numbers correct. I don't care. Ideologically, in my opinion, this is right. It has to be. Based on so many damn factors. And so many other people that are smarter than me. What I want you to see here is the fact that, yeah, geez, there's too many takeaways. Process it, look at it, and wrap your head around it. See if this makes sense to you. If it does, then let's continue the discussion. I'm gonna hit pause, take a break, put some more notes together, and we'll come in and we'll talk about the next one. We'll be talking about how we play in this environment. All right. Thanks for watching if you're still here. Appreciate it. Again, I hope it made sense. And if it did, you found value in it, please consider doing all the things, the likes, the subscribes, the notifications, the follows, the shares, and all that that will help to get the message out there. And then, by all means, this is possible by our subscribers, our row hunting resources website subscribers. And so, this is made possible by those guys, and if you would like to contribute to that, we would be greatly appreciative. But thanks, everybody. Till the next time, stay safe.